Thank you very much to the organizers for giving me the opportunity. Well, not yet. But let me say that I'm very happy once again in Catania, and that I feel in particular a very nice preparation for the whole week, this nice weather which we have. One of the local colleagues and very good old friends, Fiorella Burgio, told me just in the coffee break she felt a bit chilly this morning, so which she cannot really appreciate in the same way. I think we are very overwhelmed by this nice weather. And it's a pleasure to be here and to talk about probing beta decay by heavy ion charge exchange reaction. Ijiri-san this morning gave us a very nice overview on the light ion business and the achievements of light ion charge exchange and what can be learned. For beta decay, here I'm concentrating on the heavy ion section, and I will be very brief on single charge exchange and concentrate then in more detail and depth on double charge exchange. And as we will see, there are very interesting questions concerning, on the one hand, from a nuclear physics, structure physics, and reaction physics side, but also on the other hand, what is, so to say, the contribution of nuclear physics to neutrino physics, and what possibly could be the intersection of these two fields, and what can be fruitful collaboration in the future maybe. So the major part, or the main part of the talk, will be what I'm calling the Majorana double charge exchange reaction mechanism. And we will see what that is about, and how that is distinctive from other type of double charge exchange reactions. And I will elaborate a bit on similarities, differences between zero neutrino double beta decay operators and strong interaction operators, and then present very preliminary first results. And clearly this is work in progress. We started the whole project 1.5 years ago or so, but I think, as we will see at the end, it's a promising route to explore these difficult questions on a quite different perspective, a quite different context. Francesco Iacchello showed us this morning the, so to say, the outcome of 30 or 40 years of nuclear structure attempts to calculate nuclear matrix element for zero neutrino double beta decay. There is still the spread, and that I think calls for new approaches and a new fresh view on the problem from different perspectives. So how could we relate strong interaction physics or the hadronic world with the leptonic weak interaction world? So these are typical diagrams for beta plus and beta minus type heavy ion or nuclear charge exchange reaction, not only heavy ion ones. The set of operators in an relativistic reduction is shown here, which typically contributes that. So, we can simply replace these wavy lines with the mesons by gauge bosons, and then we have the same type of diagram also for the weak interaction. And so simply by the topology of diagrams, one can already see that there is a similarity between these two worlds. Oops, that was wrong. Nope. And also on the more detail on the operator structure, if you look to strong interaction operators, there we have interaction form factors. In weak interaction, we have interaction form factors. There are operators. Here is the same type of operators. This is a two-body interaction already. Therefore, we have the product of these operators that is written down here as a one-body operator, so it's only half of these operators. And this magnetic, weak magnetic term that is here recovered in, essentially in the rank two tensor operator, because the one can be related to the other if you multiply things. So that means there is this similarity on the operator level for single charge exchange reactions. And as Ijiri-san has showed us this morning, there is really very impressive achievement for single charging trains reactions with light ions up to the mass 3 systems to get information on these beta decay matrix elements in nuclei. And the question is, can we do similar thing, a similar success story also for heavy ion charge exchange, or for not only for heavy ion charge exchange, but say for the double beta decay and double charge exchange reactions. So single charge exchange reactions, as I said, I will be very brief, and this is showing only one transparency from one of the first, I think it might be even have been the first fully microscopic analysis of such a heavy ion charge, single charge exchange reaction 30 years ago or so. And what we see here is a very interesting picture, namely that in heavy ion reaction you really see details of the reaction mechanism, namely you can simply by looking to the angular distribution distinguishing very clearly between central interaction and tensor interaction, and so that shows, that gives you access to these details of the operator structure, provided you are able to measure these angular distributions or spectral distributions likewise in a very good precision. So as I said, there are other talks. We had this morning already Hiro Ijiri's talk, and there is Jessica Biloni. She will talk about our work, or part of the work done for the single charge exchange heavy ion. Jose Antonio Ley will talk about two-step transfer calculations, which I'm not going to discuss at all in this presentation. And Gregory Potter will talk about, as I have seen from the program, about direct reaction analysis as the method is used here behind this data. So an important issue in heavy ion or all hadronic interaction is initial and final state interactions. And one argument against heavy ion reactions might be that there is this pollution, so to say, from initial and final state interactions with the strong absorption and all those things. And that was one of the first things we have to try to understand, which we have to try to understand in detail. And that is done best in a quite different approach to reaction, or reaction theoretical approach, as usually different from usual approaches, namely try to express everything in momentum space. And that is summarized here, so we can write, include the initial and final state interaction in these distorted waves, which are essentially optical model waves, and this interaction kernel or transition potential that is can be expressed in terms of an interaction kernel given in a momentum space. And if you do so, then you see that this matrix element separates in momentum space in a contribution coming, containing all nuclear structure information and a reaction coefficient, which collects the overlap of the initial and final state relative motion wave functions with this plane wave factor. So it's a Fourier transform of the reaction transition density, so to say. The relative motion degrees of freedom are completely covered in this reaction coefficient, and so this matrix element is given then as a coherent superposition of all those reaction coefficients and this nuclear structure reaction kernel, transition kernel, and the cross-section is obtained in the usual way. So, and this one here, that will be discussed, for example, by Jessica Bellone in a poster in, on Thursday afternoon. So if you do so, and if you consider the low momentum transfer limit of those cross-sections, then one finds that indeed these multipole cross-sections split up in quantities which are exactly what Ijiri-san was discussing, namely the nuclear matrix element. These are these B coefficients and prefactors, which are given by the volume integrals of the interactions. And indeed, one can separate for low momentum transfer, one can separate off these initial and final state interactions in a scaling factor, which is energy dependent, certainly, but it's a scaling factor, and that is the important message here from this transparency, that for a strongly absorbing interaction, so it's a proton, helium-3, or a heavy ion, at low momentum transfer, you can separate the nuclear structure information from the reaction, from the elastic scattering initial final state interactions. And for small angles, indeed, you can do this separation here almost analytically. So let's come to double charge exchange reaction. We have seen this diagram here. There are these two types of interesting double beta decay processes, namely the one where we have two neutrinos emitted, which is a conventional second order process. And this afternoon, Norbert Pietralla, I suppose, will give in his talk a very good introduction in the similar process encountered in double gamma decay transitions. So that means there is a, if you want, so there's a whole class of transitions in the leptonic and also maybe in the hadronic world dealing with these second order processes. And I think double beta decay might learn from this double gamma, double photon emission studies, and maybe also from the heavy ion work, which I'm going to discuss. So there's this other one, this Majorana type process, that is something new. So it's not, it's the second order process, it looks like a second order process, but there's a correlation. If you look from a nuclear structure point of view to it, this neutrino anti-neutrino exchange, that is like a building up correlation between two nucleons. And as nuclear physicists, we are not well introduced for that phenomenon. That is what is called a short-range correlation. Here it's a long-range correlation because it's a 1 over R operator. But as I try to convince you in the next few transparencies, there's a huge similarity to strong interaction physics. So let's first look, have a look to these, what I call the double single charge exchange reaction. So it's a two-step reaction, that is this two neutrino double beta decay, or the equivalence, the surrogate reaction. And if I look the schematic diagram to it, a concrete example is this one measured here at Catania. This reaction, oxygen and calcium go into argon and neon. So that means you have a sequence of charge exchange, single charge exchange processes, and you add up those things. And from quantum mechanics, we know very well how to describe that amplitude, initial state, final state, transition operator, and intermediate many-body propagator, and that we have to work out, and then we are done. So it's easy said, but it's a lot of work to do that, as everybody knows. And if we take away, if we take away the project, the target, then we see this looks like the emission of two uncorrelated electrons, or in this case, of two mesons. The electrons are on shell, these mesons are never on shell, so they're far off shell. That is a big difference to double beta decay. And so if one works out, I'm not going into the detail, but I only want to point out that one can use the analyticity or the analytic properties of this green function to separate again the structure, the reaction part in terms of two reaction coefficients and volume integrals or T matrices of nuclear-nucleon interactions and a folding of response functions of these intermediate, of the excitation to the intermediate system and the excitation down to the final system. There's a speciality, since we are working with a non-Hermitian relative motion operator, we have to take care about the bio-orthogonality of those intermediate states. And that is very interesting because this one, this one matrix element that contains a creative operator, and this one here an absorptive operator, so they are canceling in between. And that gives the enhancement of this intermediate channel and simplifies to some extent at least the evaluation of that magic circle. The interesting part are those response functions here. That's what we have done in Gießen for over the last few years, say. And diagrammatically, it's like this. There's an external excitation operator acting on a nucleus. Then this builds up particle-hole excitations. They are correlating, interacting by the residual interaction. And so in the simplest case, this is the RPA series, what you add up there. And that can be expressed in kind of a closed form or nice, theoretically appealing structure, namely that you have an expectation value between transition operators and your intermediate many-body propagator, the nuclear propagator. From that, you get these response functions as the imaginary part. And here I show you examples for the transition from calcium to potassium, the ground state transition, that's a 4- ground state there, and here's a 1+ fluorine ground state spectral distribution. And these response functions contain two types of information, namely the spectral, the energy distribution, and the transition strengths. So that means they are combining both aspects, and they are very flexible to be extended even to the giant, to the excited region of the excited nucleon. So the delta resonance or even higher resonances can be included very easily into this scheme. Let's come now to what I find the most exciting thing, namely to try to work out the similarity between zero beta decay, zero neutrino beta decay, and strong interaction physics. So we have seen, I think Francesco Iacchello showed us already these diagrams, namely that if you have the weak interaction process, there is a gauge boson, two gauge bosons are emitted at the same time coherently, and they are converted then via this Majorana property of the neutrino, the assumed Majorana property into an electron pair. So it's obviously lepton number violated. Now we can, so that is this one. If you go now to the hadronic side, then we can have the emission, the coherent emission of two vector mesons, say, EU bar states, and they combine then, or recombine, into, in, say, two pions, which go out of the interaction zone, and another QQ bar pair, neutral QQ bar pair, which is exchanged between these two vertices. And this builds up a correlation, and here that builds up an even stronger correlation because that is short range. So the longest range in this type of process is the pion exchange. But there are also rho mesons and others which you need to take into account. This one here, that is finally on shell. So that can be observed like experiments at the Grand-Sassow. This one here is always off shell, so it never occurs in an isolated nucleus, fortunately, otherwise we would not exist. And so we need to have another partner which can provide the off shellness or absorb the off shellness of those two mesons or pairs of quarks which are emitted here, and that is clearly another nucleus. So they can serve as a sink or a source, depends on from which frame you look to it. And if that is going to happen, then this process will happen. And let's go maybe a bit more into details. So if you look for this diagram in more detail, then we have these neutral mesons, and that is a minimal set of mesons which you need in order to have an equivalent operator structure to these four currents which occur in the weak interaction business. And then there are charged mesons emitted off shell and absorbed by the target in this case, or vice versa. So you can do it the one or the other way. And clearly there are more complications. You can add always complications. There are cross diagrams and whatsoever. And this is not disturbing the overall picture. So now what we mean, so if we cut now this line here, in the, this diagram in the middle, then it's a rescattering process of a pion on a nucleon. The nucleon T matrix, the pi nucleon T matrix here, the pi nucleon T matrix there. And it's, if you read it from up to down, it's pi minus proton going to neutron and the pi zero. And that is, there's information, experimental information available. And I'll come to that in a few minutes. And then these two emitted charged mesons, off-shell mesons, they are absorbed by the target and making their two conventional single charge exchange excitation at the same time. In total, since this one here happens as a coherent correlated process, it's a one-step process. There's no intermediate propagation in the relative motion channel. So that is the difference to the double charge exchange. There you have always the propagation in the intermediate channels. So here I'm concentrating now on this diagram here. And actually, we know this process if we would reabsorb these charged pions by, within the same nucleus, by the same nucleon. This is a very well-known type of class of diagrams. Namely, that is a short-range correlation plus a vertex modification. And we know about that from ground state properties of nuclei. And you can measure that in inelastic electron scattering, where you knock out another nucleon. And that's a so-called short-range correlation modifying the ground state momentum distribution from the step function, which you expect from a pure quasi-particle system to this modified momentum distribution. And Ingo Sick has measured that 20 or 30 years ago in very much detail. And we know that is about 10 to 20% contribution to nuclear ground states. And look, considered from the other side, from another side, one could say this process which I'm discussing here is also an interesting way to measure this particular type of diagrams in a nuclear reaction. And so if we try now to make the connection to the nuclear matrix elements, that is a typical structure of the nuclear matrix element. So we see similar ingredients as we have seen it for these reaction matrix elements, namely a Fourier transform of this intermediately propagating neutrinos, or reflecting the neutrinos. This is this plane wave here. And then having the ground state expectation value of a current-current correlator. And this is a vector, pseudo-vector, actual vector magnetic, weak magnetic currents which are contributing here. And so that is then integrated over the neutrino propagator, which is shifted here by closure approximation by a certain constant energy, which is adjusted typically. So if we now look to our matrix element, to one of those vertices, then we can identify indeed, if we take these three mesons, or these mesons which I've indicated here, by having the same structures of operators. So I use now a relativistic notation, which is a more elegant way of expressing things, because that includes all higher order terms, in order of Q over Q squared and so on. And if you now look for this vertex here, then you find a form factor depending on the energy and the transferred energy or form momentum. And you find these currents, which are the same object essentially that in weak interaction. And you find the incoming and outgoing mesons, which are off-shell in our case and are fed by the partner in the same nucleus and by the second nucleus or absorbing the charged meson going out here by the second nucleus. So that means we can identify for each of those vertices the same structures than we have seen them in the weak interaction, or know them from the weak interaction piece. And now we can separate, try to make, well, let me speed up a bit. So if one looks for the full, what we might call the Majorana double charge exchange transition amplitude, then we have here these nuclear, these expectation values of the nuclear currents in the target, these two current correlator, and we have the sink or source of these off-shell mesons emitted or coming in. And this part here, that is this upper part of this diagram, which I haven't discussed, or which I'm not going to discuss in detail, this one here is this Majorana process in the, say, the target nucleus. And that now we can go on in the standard way, so to say, namely define our reaction kernel just by the Fourier transform. And interestingly, this is a one-step process, but you have to add up, if you look for the momentum balance of the whole thing, you have to add up the two momentum transfers in these two vertices. So that means the total momentum transfer is split up in a slightly different way than we are used to have it from a standard double single charge exchange. Then this defines the reaction amplitude for this Majorana process. And again, we have to integrate over the initial final state, relative motion waves, and that is done here in terms of an integral of this plane wave. And what in the plane wave limit, that means replacing those here by plane waves, then you see this is a folding with a delta function weighting, where the momentum transfer is projected on these two intermediate, two individual momentum transfers. Now let's come briefly to a first application. There are, as I said before, there are other contributions at this conference going into, first of all, the experimental details by Diana Carbone on Thursday in the second plenary morning session. Jose Antonio Ley will talk about transfer contributions, which I didn't touch at all. And Jessica will say something about single charge exchange or present things. So this T matrix is the pi nuclear T matrix, which I was discussing. They can be very well separated in an energy dependent prefactor and a momentum and the form factor, which depends on momentum transfer, because the scales are quite different. And for this prefactor, we can get immediately information from data. And this is shown here, that is our analysis of the pi minus proton, pi zero neutron cross section. What is of, and here are the real and imaginary parts of the scattering amplitude. That means we have at least this channel under control. And that plays then the role, these remaining pieces play the role of these momentum-dependent form factors in weak interaction physics. For the moment, I put them equal to a constant, so they are not considered. That has been must be found or has to be added in the future, and together with the group of Genoa, we are working on that. And what is of interest is certainly only a small energy window, say up to 100 MeV or so, as a typical house number. And so that means this part here, that is what is of our interest. So what can we say? Yeah, okay, I'm almost done. What can we say about the form factor? Well, let's skip that. So let's go directly to a first result. These are the data which we have seen already this morning. And this is now the coherent contribution of the double charge exchange, double single charge exchange, and this one channel, one possible channel, namely this pi minus, pi zero, pi minus correlated Majorana double charge exchange contribution. And you see, certainly what we get out is a typical L equals zero contribution. Here we are at the high momentum transfer. We are missing the cross section, which is, I would say, a good sign, because there are three other processes to come, and that is space enough to do so. I'll skip that, and let me make some predictions and estimates, so to say. How could one check this double charge exchange Majorana reaction in a completely different context? So try this reaction. So that's my recommendation to the experimentalist. Look for this reaction. And so if you're in beam direction, three protons coming out, then I would be very happy. And then you can also do it certainly on a heavy target. It's maybe not so clean, but it's possible. And what can we say about the rate of these double change, double charge exchange Majorana processes? So taking into account the house numbers of these Gronsvik correlations, it assumes, say, of the order of 1 to 10% of those diagrams contributing, then in total 1.1 to 1% of these double charge exchange reactions may be of this particular type. So I should point out, I'm not going through all these things, the collaboration, so that, so to say, the theory part, sub-collaboration of the human collaboration, which is busy with these questions. And that is here locally Maria Colonna and Jessica Bellone, the PhD student, Elena Santopinti, with whom we are trying to get, first of all, these the diagrammatic structure of those correlation diagrams, and then secondly also try to combine these results with IBM, nuclear structure calculation. Jose Antonio Ley from Sevilla, he's considering these transfer contributions, and together with Jose Lubian from Sao Paulo and Naftali Auerbach and myself, we are concentrating on this QRPA nuclear structure stuff. So thank you very much for your attention, and sorry for overdrawing the time.